Good morning. I'm Pastor Bonnie, and I am so grateful to be worshiping with you this morning. As we gather together online, I invite you to take a second and post a greeting in the comments and let us know who's worshiping with you today. I pray that God would bless us with a message of hope and love as we gather together online. Friends, we have a prelude this morning played by Adam. I invite you to take this time to center, to recognize that God is with us even as we gather together in our homes, wherever we are. Amen. Amen. Friends, let us share in the greeting together today. Come, share the joy of the Lord. Delight in God's goodness. Praise God who gives each person a special gift to be nurtured and shared. Lord, we thank you for these gifts. Come, let us worship God who entrusts us with so much. Lord, make us worthy of your love and trust in us. Amen. We join together as we sing our opening hymn. The words will be on your screen.
Together we serve, united by love, inviting God's world to the glorious feast. We work and we pray through sorrow and joy, extending your love to the last and the least. We seek to become a beacon of hope, a lamp for the heart and a light for the feet. We learn year by year to let love shine through, until we see Christ in each person we meet. We welcome the scarred, the wealthy, the poor, the busy, the lonely, and all who need care. We offer a home to those who will come, our hands quick to help, our hearts ready to dare. Together by grace we witness and work, remembering Jesus in whom we grow strong. Together we serve. serve in spirit and truth. Remembering love is the strength of our song.
Gracious and generous God, you are always with us, offering guidance, healing, and hope. We know that when things seem dark or are dazzling bright, when troubled times assail or peace reigns, there you are with us. Continue to guide and challenge our lives. Lead us in pathways of service and away from trails of fear and anxiety. Open our hearts to receive your healing, transforming love, that we might serve you more faithfully. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. If you have kids worshiping with you this morning, I invite you to gather them closer to the screen. It's time for our children's moment. Good morning, kids. I wanted to tell you a story about my daughter. Her name is Sarah. When she was in, I think, the fifth grade, she was given a toonie. Now, we lived in Canada at the time, and a toonie is a $2 coin. It's called a toonie for a number of reasons. It's a $2 coin, but it's also two different colors. It's gold and silver together. Now, each child in her class was given a toonie, a $2 coin, and they were invited to do something with that $2 coin, to grow it. Together, they were all going to meet back and gather their money and see what they could do with it. They were hoping to build a water well in Haiti. Now, each child in the class had different skills, different talents, different abilities. So, for example, our daughter Sarah, she loved to make friendship bracelets. Do you know what those are? Those are those bracelets that are woven together with embroidery floss. Well, she took her $2 and she went to the craft store and she bought different colors of floss, different colors of thread, and she printed up an order form. She sent it around to everyone at school and friends in the neighborhood, and she said for a dollar, she could make a friendship bracelet with two or three colors, I think maybe three colors. But for an extra 25 cents, she could make it with four colors. An extra 25 cents would be five colors. And so she took orders, and with her thread, she made friendship bracelets. When she ran out of thread, she went to the store, she had profit, and she bought more thread. And in that way, she was able to make enough bracelets from her original $2, from her original toonie, and she made over $55 that she was able to bring back to her classroom. Her friend Cress, he was taking piano lessons, and he decided that he was going to have a piano recital at his house. He used his $2 to buy refreshments, a bag of cookies, and a can to make juice. He invited everybody from his church. He went to a great big church and he invited everybody to come to his house and hear his piano recital. And so he did. People came and they crowded into his living room and he played the piano for them. And when it was done, he served cookies and juice. And then he passed around a basket. Then he took offerings. He took a collection up. Cress, using that $2 to buy juice and cookies, hosting a piano recital, raised over $75. Together, when they all came back together, they were able to raise enough money to send it to Haiti to build that water well. It was really exciting, all from each of them being given $2 coins. Our Bible study story today is about the parable of the talents. Jesus tells it, and in that story, he tells about a wealthy landowner who gives money to different people and hopes that they will kind of make it grow in the same way that my daughter's class did. The story turns out a little bit differently, but here's a good lesson from it. Each of us are blessed in a different way. God gives us different abilities, different talents, and God entrusts us to to use those things to work for good in the world. Whatever your special talent is, whether it's making friendship bracelets or playing the piano or drawing or singing, whatever that is, you can use it for God's kingdom. You can use it to spread joy and love. Let's have a prayer about that today. Dear God, thank you for making each of us very special and different. Help us to use those differences to share your love in the world. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen. Amen. Christ our Lord invites all who love him, all who earnestly repent of their sins, all who seek to be transformed by his love and grace, to confess before God and to enter into his joy. Let us confess our sins together. Lord of mercy and justice, you have given us so many talents and gifts to be used in your world. You have given us these gifts because you trust us to use them well, and you will be with us in all our work. But we disappoint you when we denigrate the value of the talents and become so fearful of failure that we don't believe that we are capable of helping in this world. Lord, forgive us. Help us to trust in the gifts you have given to us and to trust in your guidance in using them. Forgive us when we are fearful or stubborn, apathetic or indifferent to the needs around us. Give us hearts for serving you all our days. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Rejoice and celebrate. God has placed God's trust and love deep within your hearts. You have been called and trusted to serve God. Alleluia. Praise be to God. Amen. Whomever you are with, I invite you to show signs of peace and love with them this morning. Join me in the prayer for illumination. Living God, by the power of your Spirit, help us to truly hear your holy word, that we may understand, that understanding we may believe, and believing we may follow in faithfulness and obedience, seeking your honor and glory in all that we do. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our scripture lesson today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, Chapters 25, verses 14 through 30. For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, to each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, "Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I've made 5 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You've been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." And the one with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, "Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I've made 2 more talents. His master said to him, "Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You've been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master." Then the one who had received the one talent also came forward, saying, "Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow, and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours." But his master replied, "You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one who has 10 talents. For to all who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth." This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. I sent an email this week to the worship team asking them to think ahead to Christmas Eve. Advent is approaching, and then Christmastide, and then Lent and Easter. Those seem like the highlights of the church year, when we bring out the special colors of the year, the blues of Advent, white for Christmas, purple for Lent. But right now, we are in a season of the Christian year referred to as ordinary time. Ordinary time, but there's nothing about this time that feels ordinary to me. We're in pandemic, there's tumultuous politics, volatile economics, devastating storms, widening disparity, and even violent racism. Nothing feels ordinary. And even our lectionary texts don't seem ordinary to me. I would rather hear Bible stories about good neighbors and resourceful friends or even miraculous luncheons instead of the stories that we are encountering in these past few weeks. These readings have been full of apocalyptic prophecies and judgment. Some leads to life and some to death. These parables are hard. And I really just want to quickly read them and skip to the easy interpretation. Today's lesson, if we were to just read the Cliff Notes version, would remind us that we have all been blessed, abundantly blessed with time and money and talents. Look at our lives. We've got everything we could ever need, most of what we want, and plenty of what we don't actually have any use for. And we shouldn't squander these blessings. We need to be good stewards for the kingdom of God. We've been entrusted. And if we aren't, we might be cast out into the darkness like that third slave, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. I mean, that's a pretty simple interpretation, and it's easy to understand. We've all got it, and so maybe we should just cut to lunch. If I sound a little bit irreverent, a bit tongue-in-cheek, I apologize, but it's just that this parable reminds me of fairy tales, those stories told to scare children into obedience, like the story of Hansel and Gretel, the ultimate story of stranger danger, or the story of the Little Red Riding Hood and the Big Bad Wolf. That one keeps children from straying too far from home. Jesus tells this parable, bookended by the parable of the 10 bridesmaids, that's the one we heard last week, and the parable of the judgment of the nations, which I usually think of as the parable of the sheep and the goats. And it's frightening to read these three parables, especially in one sitting, for me anyways, because I think of Jesus as loving and kind and merciful and compassionate. Jesus loves everyone, forgives all, and everyone will be welcomed into the kingdom of glory when Jesus comes again. I don't really like to think about the judgment of the living and the dead. But Matthew likes to remind us that there is judgment, that judgment is a real thing, And maybe even that Jesus has a hard side, a side that demands much and will not hesitate to dole out consequences. So we read these three parables and we feel a bit of fear at the idea of the coming judgment. We send in our offerings, we volunteer occasionally, maybe once a year or twice a year, and we breathe a sigh of relief. And I wonder if Jesus breathes a sigh of relief too, as he thinks, looks like things are going exactly as planned. Somehow I don't think so. Instead, I think the Holy Spirit is working in us, inviting us to take a closer look. Look again, the Holy Spirit urges us and puts a sense of unease in us. There's more, the Holy Spirit whispers. And so I look again, and my plan for a quick and easy sermon falls apart. Talents in this text, are they about money? Is this a text about money, about our God-given talents? This amount of money is astronomical. It's over 100 years' wages. Estimates in our current economy say that this would be like $60 billion, and I can't even comprehend that amount of money. And I'm sure that the impoverished people that were gathering to hear Jesus speaking, including the disciples, wouldn't have been able to wrap their minds around it either. It would be like winning the jackpot or more every single year, and what else could be that valuable? Maybe, instead of thinking about money or God-given abilities, let's think about faith. Faith in the gospel and callings or opportunities to share the good news. How long have those three slaves been slaves for this master? Certainly long enough to have developed some sort of relationship with him so that he's willing to divide up all his possessions among them. Long enough that he knows what each of them are capable of. Long enough that they know the ways of the master. So the master leaves, trusting that they will be good stewards of all of his wealth. Two of them take to heart what they know of the master. They live like him, follow in his ways, and double the value of what they've been given, what they've been entrusted with. But one of them doesn't. His perspective of the master is different. Where the others saw cleverness and shrewd business dealings, the third slave saw harshness, maybe even unethical behavior. And so he did what any good, honest Jewish citizen would do. He buried the treasure for safekeeping. But what if the treasure is faith? As I said, all three have been with this master for a long time and they know his ways, they know what is important to him, and they've seen him in action, reaping where he did not sow. Could that be bringing Gentiles into the fold or offering compassion to a prostitute? Healing one who'd already been sentenced to death? And as the master departs, he gives them everything he's ever taught them about mercy and compassion and forgiveness, about the gospel. Something so valuable that we can only describe it as $60 billion worth of hope. And he entrusts them to keep doing the work that he started. So the first slave takes his faith, his portion of the gospel, and gets busy with it. He seeks opportunities to share his faith in the gospel, and he cares for others, even those who are not Jewish, not like him, and he reaps where he did not sow, and the gospel grows. His faith grows. The second slave does the same, but the third slave, he saw the master through the eyes of the world. He saw the master offering compassion to someone unworthy, inviting those who were unclean to eat at his table, and he refused to participate. He declined the opportunities. He didn't take to heart everything the master had showed him. Well, eventually the master returns. The first and second slaves are commended and rewarded for their care of the gospel, for their faith and how they worked to grow it. but the third is condemned. He refused to grow his faith, refused to take to heart the teaching of the Master, and instead buried it, adopting the ways of the world instead of the ways of the Master. But I wonder if the Holy Spirit is still working in you. And I wonder if you are still as uncomfortable as I am with this also easy interpretation. Because there's still a tightness in my chest as I think about that. Am I being a good steward of the gospel of faith? Can you hear the Holy Spirit say, "Look again"? I wonder if the people hearing this story from the lips of Jesus himself, would they have identified the Master as God as we tend to do? Is God a harsh God, reaping where God doesn't sow, gathering where God doesn't scatter seed? That doesn't sound at all like Jesus to me. And I wonder if instead, to the early listeners, it sounded like he was talking about the Romans. Maybe the early listeners were hearing the parable and wondering if the Master was the Romans, who had so much power and wealth that they'd enslaved the Jews. In fact, they'd recruited some Jews to work for them in exchange for power and privilege. And those Jews would have still been slaves, but they had a better position in the Roman ways of the world. They'd been entrusted with much, collecting taxes and keeping the Roman laws and keeping their own kind in line and peaceable, and in return, they received more. And maybe the third slave is Jesus. Jesus, the one who humbles himself so that like a slave, he washes the disciples' feet. Jesus, the one who refuses to play the Roman games, who refuses to live like a master and instead is cast out, hung on a cross, and crucified. Jesus, who is at heart a revolutionary, is inviting the crowd to think critically about what is going on in the world in that often confusing way that Jesus does. For those who are listening to Jesus tell this parable, they understood that the only way you could become more and more wealthy was to defraud others, to take advantage of others. The Roman world rewards those who exploit others. The rich get richer and the poor get poorer. And so perhaps in this parable, Jesus is shining a light into the darkness, exposing the reality of the Roman Empire and the complicitness of the enslaved Jews who adopt the Roman ways. Maybe the early listeners are wondering, why is one slave better than the other? What makes that one so special? Aren't they all equal? Really, they're all just slaves. Is Jesus inviting his listeners to reject the ways of the world, the ways of the Master, even if it means being cast out and rejected? He said that before. Remember earlier, Matthew records Jesus' warning when he says, "See, I'm sending you out like sheep into the midst of wolves, so be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of them, for they will hand you over to councils and flog you in their synagogues, and you will be dragged before governors and kings because of me, as a testimony to them and the Gentiles. You will be hated by all because of my name, but the one who endures to the end will be saved." Jesus has warned in the past that his followers will be rejected, even in their hometowns. Is that the message for us this day? That we live in this world but are not of this world. We ought to remember Jesus' ways, how he lived his life, and do likewise. When those around us seek to throw stones or hurl hatred, do we recall the humble servant Jesus who stepped in and spoke out against the persecutors? Perhaps that is what it means to be good stewards with all that we've been entrusted with. Stewardship, whether of money or even faith, means that we are called by a revolutionary, radical Christ to take a risk, to reject the ways of this world, to reject the ways of the Master, to reject a system that puts one person over another, to reject a system that puts us in competition where we're striving to outdo each other, to reject a system where those who have more are given more because they're better at taking advantage of those less fortunate, even if it means that we lose our place of privilege in the world. Dr. Cynthia Rigby, a professor of theology at Austin Presbyterian Theological Seminary, would often say in her lectures, "I don't know much, but I know this much," before starting into her conclusion of a lecture. Well, friends, I don't know much, but I know this much. Jesus does give to us abundantly. We are blessed, extravagantly blessed, and we have a calling to be good stewards of all that we've been given. We are called to share the gospel, to share our faith in such a way that mercy and justice and love grow, just as Jesus Christ our Lord modeled for us. As we take to heart Christ's ways and the ways of the world, which are not God's ways, know that those will not overpower us. And let us all look forward to the day when we hear God say, "Well done, enter into my joy." And let all of God's people say, "Amen." Friends, I invite you to join in our hymn of response. It's a song by Hillsong called "This I Believe," a version of the Creed.
Our Father everlasting, the uncreating one, God Almighty, through your Holy Spirit conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender suffered and crucified. Forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious life. Forever seated high. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in you, yes, I believe you rose again, yes, I believe that Jesus Christ is Lord. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus.
Let us now join together in prayer. Holy and loving God, we come together in prayer, lifting our voices to you with faithful Christians in every corner of the earth. In your infinite love, we have each been called to use our talents for the good of those around us. Let us pray that we are able to increase and develop our gifts to be acceptable to you, O Lord. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray that our minds and hearts may be filled with all that is good, all that is pure and noble, so that we may become living examples of God's love for the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who exploit the poor, those who create the social structures that cause poverty and homelessness. May they see the poor as brothers and sisters, as siblings, as children of God. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for all those who are working for understanding and tolerance in our multi-faith, multicultural world. We pray especially that we will take the lead in building bridges of friendship and understanding with other faiths and other ethnicities in our communities. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for all those suffering as a result of the pandemic. May we all take up our responsibility and help the poorest in society. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for all who cry for justice and peace. May they be heard by those in power. May they accept a just and peaceful way of change and reconciliation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We remember all who are sick, those in hospital and those who are housebound. May the hospitals and medical staff be given what they need to bring healing and comfort. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We spend a few moments in silence now before you, Lord. We have so many things left unsaid weighing on our hearts. Search us and know us. Meet us in these moments. Almighty and ever-living God, we are the body of Christ and your church scattered around the world, united in Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let us join together in our hymn of prayer. The words will be on your screen.
Jesus, keep me near the cross. There a precious fountain, free to all a healing stream, flows from Calvary's mountain. In the cross, in the cross, be my glory ever. A trembling soul. the bright and morning star sheds its beams around me. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross, O Lamb of God, bring its seams before me. Help me walk from day to day with its shadow o'er me. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river. Near the cross I'll watch and wait, hoping, trusting ever, till I reach the golden strand just beyond the river. In the cross, be my glory ever, till my raptured soul shall find rest beyond the river.
It's incredible to be thinking about Christmas, but we are already in mid-November. I find it hard to believe, but it's true. In the past, at Christmas, St. Luke has participated in a special mission. Last year, we adopted an incredible family and we gathered things to send to the border. We have been blessed. But this year, because of the pandemic, things are a little bit different. Instead, we will be offering an alternative gift market, which will go live on the first week of Advent, the first Sunday of Advent, November 29th. So rather than purchasing gifts for your loved ones who have really everything they need already, you'll have an opportunity to support a charity in their honor. We will have a variety of wonderful charities, many of them local and some of them global ministries of the United Methodist Church to choose from. We've also commissioned a local artist, Lacey Richter, to design an original St. Luke Christmas card. So when you donate to the charity of your choice, you'll receive a set of cards to send to your loved ones with an information tag about the charity that you supported. You can write your well wishes in the card and let your recipients know that a donation has been made in their honor. We pray that this will be a blessing to you, as it will be a blessing to all of the charities receiving our support this year. It is with great joy that we share our morning offering today. It is a vital reminder of the many ways in which we can serve God through the ministries and mission of this church. Friends, let us joyfully offer prayers for our offering today. Let us pray. Lord of blessings and of hope, we give to you these gifts as tokens of our lives. We pray that you would use these gifts for healing and hope in your world. Use us as instruments of peace, as instruments of justice. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. praise God, all of ye heavenly host, Creator Christ and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Friends, just an announcement before we close. The Austin studio tour began this weekend, and we are a studio location. Arts in the A-Frame, a ministry of St. Luke, is featuring three local artists, Amber Perry, Lacey Richter, and Laura Williams, in our gallery and in our studio space. I invite you to check us out online for more information about how you can see the incredible talent here in Austin. Let's join together in our closing hymn. The words will be on your screen.
I'm gonna live so God can use me anywhere, Lord, anytime. I'm gonna live so God can use me anywhere, Lord, anytime. I'm gonna work so God can use me anywhere, Lord, anytime. I'm gonna work so God can use me anywhere, Lord, anytime. I'm gonna pray so God can use me anywhere, Lord, anytime. I'm gonna pray so God can use me anywhere, Lord, anytime. Well, I'm gonna sing so God can use me anywhere, Lord, anytime. I'm gonna sing so God can use me anywhere, Lord, anytime. I'm gonna live so God can use me anywhere, Lord, anytime. I'm gonna live so God can use me anywhere, Lord, anytime. Anywhere, Lord, anytime.
Friends, hear this benediction. Go forth into God's world as children of light, offering ministries of hope and healing to a hurting world. Go forth, filled with God's abundant love. Go forth in peace. Amen. Amen. Let's join together as we sing our Irish blessing.
May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm on your face. And the river